Bulabinaka, and welcome to For the Record. My guest tonight is the Executive Chair of the Biosecurity Authority of Fiji, Mr. Xavier Riaz Khan. We'll be talking about what the Biosecurity Authority of Fiji does and what it's all about and how it makes a difference in the lives of everyday Fijians. Riaz, thank you very much for being on the show this evening. Let's begin by going into what the Biosecurity Authority does in general. It is an authority that is responsible for ensuring there are no invasive pests that come into the country. That's a general description, but there's a whole lot more that goes into it, isn't there?
Yes, Edwin, thank you. Before I proceed in highlighting the actual functions of the organization and what the organization is mandated to do, I know biosecurity is a word which is very new to all of us Fijians. And we have to understand biosecurity is basically securing our biodiversity in very simple layman terms. So Biosecurity Authority Fiji being reorganized from Quarantine Inspection Department and still being under major reorganization, it's mandated under the Biosecurity Promulgation of 2008, the Act now, to basically prevent the entry of exotic pests and diseases in the country. That includes plant and plant pests, animal and animal disease, and includes genetic material to tissue material, and basically it extends to every other material which is related to biodiversity. And biodiversity, we know very well, it's everything all around us. So the organization plays a very crucial role at the border, not only the border, but pre-border, which is under international cooperation. We negotiate conditions, protocols with the exporting importing country, which is Fiji, and the exporting country. And apart from that, we ensure that whatever is been negotiated is adhered to at the border, and at the border we facilitate the normal process of clearance, inspection, appropriate quarantine treatment, and after that is post-border where the inspection takes place, which is mainly for the goods and whatever is imported in the country. And apart from that, the organization is also mandated to basically ensure that we are aligned with the international practices and standards. That basically means that while the organization is mandated to look after the entry of exotic pests and diseases, we have international obligations, regional obligations, which we have to comply to. And we have to ensure that whatever is exported from Fiji is free of pests and diseases. And that is an assurance which we have with the both parties under the bilaterals we sign. So looking at the organization, it was a very crucial road at the border. And as you must have heard, it's a latest tripartite agreement between WHO, FAO, and OIE, which basically means one health approach, which is farm to fork. So whatever you plant, if you're planting grass or pasture, so if you're goats, you may have your vegetables, that's your vegetables on your table, and you basically have a goat or lamb, whatever you have your lamb on your table. So basically, from farm to fork, we have to ensure that we eliminate all the biosecurity risks, which is basically preventing the spread of zoonotic diseases. And zoonotic diseases are basically diseases which pass from animals to human beings, and we play the crucial role to basically prevent the introduction of zoonotic diseases. So apart from the zoonotic disease introduction, we have to also ensure that we report to OIE, to IPPC. OIE is World Organization for Animal Health. We have to ensure that we appropriately report the disease status of the country and for the trading partners to access to and also develop protocols while we're trading. Apart from that is International Plant Protection Convention, which is IPPC. So that's for plant and plant products. So that's how a lot of works. And we are also engaging with other international partners to ensure that we are moving with time as trade is changing, the trading environment is changing, regional approaches change. So we are also ensuring that we move with time. We ensure we comply with all the sanitary and phytosanitary requirements of the international or trading countries. So that is, in a nutshell, a bird's eye view of what organization does.
Looking at it from back when it was the quarantine department to what it is now, biosecurity, a lot has changed in terms of the operations of the organization. But our compliance level on an international scale, because of all these agreements that you have signed on to and all these partnerships that BAF now has, what is our compliance level generally?
Looking at from Quarantine Inspection Department being reorganized, and it was, I think, one of the government's best strategy to improve service delivery, and also on the same note, to ensure that we are able to reach to the compliance level where we have that level feel with the training partners, that the training partners have that assurance in the competent authorities of Fiji that whatever we're certifying is free of pests and diseases. And a classic example is the suspension which we had with the fruit and vegetables with New Zealand, papaya, breadfruit, and so on. And looking at that, I know there is significant impact on the trade, but on the same note, one has to understand that whatever we plant, whatever we harvest, we have to ensure that there is value adding. And we also ensure that all pests and diseases are eliminated before it's exported. So that was a good exercise for all our stakeholders to get together, work together, and also ensure that we achieve that compliance. So looking at overview of Fiji's compliance, we're trying to achieve it, but I must also highlight that biosecurity risks change every day. There may be a risk something today, but tomorrow it will be mitigated. But next day it may be another risk. So a classic example is avian flu. So there may be outbreaks every day, and under the World Organization for Animal Health, we have a notification system where the partners notify us through the platform, which is the WAHIS platform from OIE. So this is notifications, and our veterinary team, the animal section, they ensure that our conditions, our importation requirements are accordingly changed as the disease pattern changes.
So far as border control is concerned, with your officers at the various ports of entry, there have been instances where pests have been detected on containers and shipments. How important is this work, and what are some of the very common things that you encounter?
Looking at the border operations, it's one of the most crucial operations of the organization, as border protection is paramount. So common examples which you see at the border is giant African snail. We don't have giant African snails in Fiji, but just because we are a trading hub in the Oceania region, so we have introduction via transshipments. So this identification or interception of this pest at the border are classic examples of stringent measures, improvement in compliance at border. And it's not this organization alone. Biosecurity Authority Fiji has improved its compliance. Yes, it is improved, but also it's a collaboration which we have at the border. We work with the Fiji Revenue and Customs Authority, we work with the Ports Authority, we work with the police. So we work together to ensure that we are able to achieve that level of compliance, and also the security which we're trying to achieve, because protection of our biodiversity is very important as it affects our livelihoods. And a classic example is termites and iguana which we have. So it is an exotic pest which has entered the country and basically causing devastating, it is devastating the whole infrastructure, the industry. So taking into consideration the two examples we have on hand, we want to ensure that we improve our compliance at border, we're more vigilant, and also we pass that ownership to people that biosecurity alone is just a regulatory agency. It's there to basically ensure that we're able to increase awareness, ensure the public is aware of what biosecurity is. But on the same note, we pass that ownership to the Fijians, because Fijians play a very important role, because as an organization, we're not all over Fiji. So we're trying to improve presence by signing MOUs to ensure that we have our counterparts who are actually notifying us, and it really works very well. We have MOUs with police, FERCA, MSF. So looking at that, in a nutshell, as an organization, we ensure that we are passing that ownership to people to ensure that ownership is there, so that we take responsibility and we're more cautious. Because if you see realistically, in normal environment, we may have restrictions. We have emergency declarations of movement of animals. We have emergency declaration of movement of termite products, termite in host materials. So looking at that, I know it sounds like a red tape when you put those declarations in place. But one has to understand that the impact of that movement, if you're basically moving a host material, which is termite host material like old furniture or so from an infested area, hot zone, if you move that for your best interest, maybe short term you're very happy about it, but in long term you are introducing that pest, which is termites, from one hot spot or buffer zone to a new area.
You're basically spreading the
yes,
termites.
You're basically spreading. So right. It's very important.
Of course. We're going to take a short break, but I would like to talk about this termite infestation in the next segment. We'll take a quick break. Stay with us. Bulavanaka, and welcome back to the show. My guest is the Executive Chair of the Biosecurity Authority of Fiji, Mr. Xavier Riaz Khan. Riaz, before the break, you were talking about the Asian subterranean termites. They've been here for a number of years now, and people continue to ask how and when they will be eradicated. I understand that the problem is such that it's more about managing the pest than eradicating. How is biosecurity approaching this?
I do not think you're very succinctly put the question to me. When a pest enters a country, we ensure we try to eliminate it. And elimination of pest or diseases is basically through, as I highlighted earlier, the negotiation of import protocols, vaccination, and so on, which we basically ensure that all quarantine treatments are done, that we mitigate and eliminate the pest. But once it is introduced in the country, we ensure we try our best, we endeavor to basically eliminate the pest. But looking at the pest, as different pests behave differently. So if something which is not seen under a microscope or needs more high-level diagnostics, we may be able to only mitigate it, contain it. So if you look at termites approach, we are trying our best to ensure that we are able to mitigate the issue on hand. And also, prevent the spread of the infestations. But if you look at, for example, giant invasive iguana, it is something which can be caught very easily. As you can see, it's a moving animal, you can catch it. But when you compare that with the termites, there are two different scenarios. So for giant invasive iguana, we're working with the Global Environment Facility, we've submitted a project, it's in the final stages of endorsement by CEO, where we'll be having project implemented at the ground, basically for elimination or eradication of the pest. But for termites, we are containing it. But with the current strategy in place, where we are now working with the Ministry of Local Government to ensure that we are improving our building codes, and also the government, through the government grants, have provided the treatment, the chemicals, so which BAF actually provides all treatment for free of charge currently. But we're trying to find a way forward as how best we can address this. But as an organization, we may treat. Mm-hmm. We may have inspected about approximately 8,000 houses and treated maybe about 6,000 or so houses. However, if we don't take ownership, if we continue moving material out of the investor zone, then we'll be not able to mitigate or suppress the issue which we have on hand or mitigate that movement issues. So it's very important for Fijians to take the ownership and have that basic understanding that maybe a timber is timber, but if you're building your house with untreated timber in an infested zone, then you're basically asking for more risks, more issues on hand in future. But if you look at movement of those to another area, we have to understand that we have a very good tourism industry. We have a lot of infrastructure developments and so on. So the impact of introduction of termites may have significant impact on the trade and on the economy. So we have to take understanding it affects our livelihoods. So if you relate things from the border to the actual infestation to our livelihoods, we have to all understand, as an organization, we ensure we pass the information and we can address what we can address with the measures we have, but we all have to work together as a team, as a Fiji team, to ensure that we're able to eradicate the issue.
Are you confident that the measures are working and there's been no spread or infestation that BEF may not be aware of?
Edwin,
do you get sporadic reports from outside the hotspots?
Edwin, you do get compliance and calls and inquiries, but we have to understand there are different types of termites. We have some local termites too, and we also have the exotic, which is AST, which is Asian subterranean termite. So our entomologists basically, they always look at the specimens and basically do the diagnostics. And if it is local termites, then there is measures in place with the local fumigating companies, pest control companies. And if it is exotic, which is basically Asian subterranean termite, so we ensure that the appropriate treatment is done. However, we also collaborating, looking at the Queensland model, how there is a threat of $2 billion threat to the Queensland infrastructures. So they also have AST in Queensland, and we're using the same chemicals, same strategy which has been used, but looking at their success and looking at Fiji's success in terms of mitigating the termites. When you compare both economies of scale, if you look at introduction of new building codes, maybe that's one of the best strategies to mitigate, but treatment of timbers, building with the high graded treated timbers are the ways to actually address. So we're taking a more holistic approach, having more stakeholder engagements to ensure that we're all taking part in the actual issue on hand.
And when you say stakeholders, does that include the timber companies? Are they on board with the treatment of timber?
You must have noted that we have also signed an MOU with Consumer Council of Fiji, and we're also working with the Ministry of Local Government. In regards to the retailers, we have discussed the matter before with the regulatory agency, which looked after the retailers. However, the Department of Forestry, we view the Department of Forestry as the best entity we may actually engage in. However, working, the consumers play the most critical role, because maybe at some locations you don't need to treat timbers to build, and looking at the cost and so on. So customers have to be more, which is the Fijians have to be more aware of the issue than actually putting more regulatory or regulatory measures on the retailers. So retailers have option to sell for sure, but you have to always educate your consumers that what you're buying is what you're buying. If you're buying a treated timber, it has to be treated timber. So that's Consumer Council is there to assist us on that. So we'll be working to ensure that we address those issues.
All right, with that, we've come to the end of another segment. We'll be back shortly. Good evening and welcome back to For the Record. Riaz, you spoke earlier about the elimination of the invasive iguanas. I note that BEF has signed with the Global Environment Facility funding of $7 million to get this project going. Are you confident that we can eliminate the iguanas? What plans do you have?
Looking at the project proposal, which we have worked with the implementing partner, which is UNDP, from the initial pro-document approval phase to actual development of the proposal with the help of the international consultants, and further negotiation with the UNDP Manila, Thailand office, and also Washington. Looking at the proposal, we have a series of activities in that. One activity is basically eradication of Giant iguana on the island of Gomera. And on the same note, looking at the impact of that on the surrounding islets, which is the Lodala, Matangi, Tavuni, and also looking at the social impacts, economic impacts, and also seeing how feasible it will be in way forward to put in measures. So the first approach we have taken, which is currently at operation level being executed, is improving presence, compliance, and border control. So we have presence of all the borders. As you may have noted, that we have presence up in Savu, we have presence up in Tavuni, to ensure that the movements are restricted. If there is movements, we ensure that we restrict it. But looking at the whole picture of iguana eradication, as I've highlighted earlier, there is also issue of our local iguana mutations and so on. So we don't have expertise locally, habitologists locally, to provide a technical advice on that. So with that project, we'll be having technical consultants also in, who are basically experts seconded here in Fiji for assisting BEF and also other stakeholders, environment and other NGOs, to ensure that we work together to develop a strategy which is best for Fiji, taking in consideration the challenges you want.
And do you have that strategy in place now? Is it likely to be rolled out soon?
Yes. Looking at the approval process of JAF, as I said, we have gone to the final stages of endorsement. All technical comments and consultations have been completed, negotiations have been completed, and it was a tedious task, but I must acknowledge all the parties involved. And the rollout will be from June, where the project starts for 4 years. And project has specific modules which will be basically implemented with specific work plans. So we are very confident in the actual project document, where we'll be also using the latest technologies to ensure that we're able to ascertain what is the status of Janusik 1 on the island of Gamel, Atoll, and Matangi. And looking at the stakeholder engagements, I think we have a lot of good support with the local partners, local stakeholders. So we want to ensure that we address this issue very amicably and resolve the current issues on hand also. But as I said, there's risks every day at the border. So we want to ensure that we are able to divert resources appropriately and in a manner where we're able to address the exotic risks at the border, also ensure that we're able to address what we have.
At one point, there was a situation where people were being told, you know, you go out and you catch these iguanas and you kill them or whatever, and there were rewards being given out. Is that still continuing?
The bounty strategy, if you look at international settings, bounty strategy, there are advantages and disadvantages of it. Some may abuse the system, some may not abuse the system. But looking at the strategy and looking at what the international consultants have put forward, what we have now been discussing with the team on the ground is that we have to ensure that there's more awareness and the people of Gamea, Lodala, Matangi take that ownership, that we have to ensure that we eliminate to prevent our vegetation being eaten away. So the bounty strategy is there. We have not scrapped it, but having the project rolled out from June, we'll be in a better position to ascertain if we should continue with the bounty strategy or totally eradicate and increase the manpower instead.
Now, looking at some of the other issues, everyday issues that BAF works on, trade facilitation, imports and exports, as you mentioned, ensuring that our products have all the certification. Just recently, your offices inspected two offices in the Western Division involved with, I understand it's got to do with the fumigation and what have you. And their operations have been suspended. How does that work? I mean, they are licensed and then they have to meet standards, but biosecurity stepped in. What exactly happened?
Okay. From 2013, we've been working on the Australian Fumigation Accreditation Scheme. It's called AFS. And we'll be also working in a sea container hygiene system. And as you're aware, in 2015, we had the AFS been launched and the sea container hygiene system been approved this year. So both are basically quarantine measures, which is pre-shipment quarantine measures, which is used to eliminate pests before it's exported. And a classic example is ginger export to Australia, where we require to fumigate. And for export, for movement of containers from Fiji or transiting from Fiji, they need to comply with the clean container requirements of sea container hygiene system. So looking at the fumigation aspect, where there is suspension under the joint review with the Department of Agriculture Australia and the Biosecurity Authority Fiji, as we have the bilateral arrangement on the AFS, we had the audit visit by the inspectors from Australia last year, and there were corrective measures to be implemented. Unfortunately, some of the measures maybe were not implemented, and those are basically the reason why there is suspension. BAF doesn't do the suspension. It's Department of Agriculture and Water Resources from Australia. They suspend, and now BAF will be working with these local stakeholders to ensure they achieve the level of compliance before they are basically listed as the approved fumigation providers. So they are approved fumigation providers which are accredited by Australian authorities whose fumigation standards are in compliance with the Australian standards. So if you look at export of wood chips, export of fresh fruit, vegetables, some countries may require fumigation, some countries may not require fumigation. But looking at the government's vision, as organics is the way forward. So you may have noted we are working on our legislations. We are working with FAO and also with OIE. There's a lot of missions that happen with OIE and FAO to ensure that we are in compliance with the training partners. As the word pesticide residue, antibiotic residues, antimicrobial resistance may sound very technologically big words. However, if you look at the actual process or actual what it encompasses, the pesticide residues, antibody residue, and organics, which the Fijian government is pushing for all the farmers, all the exporters to look into and also invest in, they all tie in together because our legislation needs to be improved and brought to a level where we are in compliance with the Australian legislations, as Australian legislation has been just recently changed, where they include animal, plant, food, and human biosecurity. So there are different models of biosecurity acts, but as I highlighted earlier, the farm-to-fork approach and pesticide residue, antibody residue, they work in hand in hand. As the pesticide you use on the farm will basically the residues in your fruit. The antibodies which you use on animals will be the residues in your corned beef or lamb, whatever you basically are buying and consuming. And the impact of that is basically on the human beings. So for us to comply with that approach, which is an international approach, and for us to trade with the trading partners like Australia and New Zealand, the common ones, we have to ensure that we also improve our legislations. Improving exports, improving production is vital for food security. But we have to also ensure that we are moving in time with the compliance. So BAF is working with all the donor partners to ensure that we are in compliance with trading partners. And with BAF's processes, we have instilled transparent processes, and this is merely to do with compliance. And we have to also understand that there's something called Codex Alimentarius. It's the international setting bodies for food. So we are working together to ensure we have a MOU with Ministry of Health for us to work together on all the other areas, and food is vital. Mm-hmm. So our key priority at the moment is to ensure that our, from farm to fork, all our compliance, all regulations are in order to ensure that all Fijians are safe from counterfeiting, from products introduced in the country which may have, which may lead to spread of zoonotic diseases, pandemics, and so those things are priority for organizations like BAF.
Okay, and with that, we've come to the end of another segment. We're going to take a short break now. Welcome back to For the Record. My guest is the Executive Chair of the Biosecurity Authority of Fiji, Mr. Xavier Riaz Khan. Riaz, one of the issues locally for the past few years has been bovine tuberculosis. We had brucellosis, that's pretty much been taken care of to a large extent, but we're now hearing of tuberculosis spreading across dairy farms. How is biosecurity helping with this?
Edwin, tuberculosis is an issue in human health. It's a human health issue, it's an animal health issue also. It's a disease which basically causes both human beings and animals. And one has to understand the disease spreads from animals to human beings. There may be two different strains of the disease, but they are basically the cause in human beings also. Looking at the past evidence-based, what was being available in the literature, the spread was not confirmed, but now it's confirmed, it does spread. So taking in consideration the international practices, looking at our neighboring countries, how they have the mitigation and processes in place. The animal movement restrictions is something not new which we introduced in Fiji. We're not introducing something which has been not anywhere, or not available or not been used or implemented anywhere in the world. It's available everywhere in the world. If you look at Australian websites, the animal movement is a process where we restrict the movements of animals, but we're not restricting the movement of animals, we're restricting the movement of the disease. And few areas which is very important for us to understand is that the animal census has to happen in the country every year, which is very important to understand what is your gross livestock, which basically gives us the opportunity to better negotiate and improve the pathway and introduce new pathways. So market access is an area which we work. But looking at the bovine tuberculosis issue, the national identification system has to be there, which is the tagging of the animals, sensors. So based on that, there is movements. If you look at Ireland setting, if you look at UK setting, if you look at Australian setting, they all have the same process where tagging has to happen. The movement is approvals are given. But apart from that, the introduction of the bovine tuberculosis from one area to the next area, it's an issue. And with the current test available, which is tuberculin test, where there is prick on the skin and it's basically seen after 7 days, you feel it. It's one of the initial diagnostics available. But to further pass that animal to the abattoir to be culled, you have to have a confirmatory test. That's an international practice, that without a confirmatory test, which is either having blood, doing PCR tests or so on, that basically allows the farmer or the authority to confirm that the cattle can be slaughtered. However, the meat inspectors ensure it's safe for human consumption. Otherwise, it has to be incinerated or decomposed or whatever strategy is in place. So looking at the current process, what the organization has done from the organization's point of view and also taken a more holistic approach is restrictions in place to ensure that the introduction of disease from one division or from one district is not passed on to another district. However, if you're on the roads, you'll see that movement still happens. And we work with Ministry of Agriculture. We have a system in place where the team of Ministry of Agriculture, BTEC, are basically doing the field testing and so on. And we're working with the FMIB, Fiji Meat Industry Board, to ensure that whatever is been all the animals coming to for slaughter are basically positive cattle, and we have officers who visit the FMIB to ensure that the information is provided. As one of the mandatory requirements of WTO member countries as Fiji, that we report all this disease to OIE. And OIE delegation, the responsibilities have been just assumed from Ministry of Agriculture in 2015. And we're working now with all the partners to ensure that it's most transparently reported. And also, what is available in terms of animal welfare, and also on in terms of confirmatory tests and so on, which is available locally, is provided and is made public for everyone to understand how it works. And that is the whole reason why you must have noted the organization is basically giving out notices, alerts to ensure that everyone understands what is the purpose of the restrictions. I know it may seem like a red tape, but it is the best approach in the best interest of everyone as introduction of the tuberculosis, maybe from air, it's airborne and so on, airborne also. So movement may seem a red tape. But actually, if you look at it from trade point of view, from livelihood point of view, it may have significant impact. So there is a current strategy in place. And I must thank the stakeholders who have actually taken a very positive approach, who are now working and working together with BAF to ensure that we are able to address this issue on hand.
Do you believe some farming practices also need to be addressed, given that it's a pretty old industry and farmers have been doing it their way for so many years now, and then now biosecurity is coming in and saying, look, you may not be doing this right and you may not be doing that right, and this is the proper way to go. Farming methods?
Edwin, look at the farming methods. There are different types of farming methods. If you look at the intensive farming and extensive farming, having more farms with more animals and having animals basically which is out in the field as we have in Fiji approach, and having more controlled farming, there are a lot of risks. Introduction of disease in a more controlled farming has more significant impact than having what we have in Fiji approach. So if you look at the farming approaches, what I understand, what is more important is having that awareness at the farm level that if you see any sort of signs and symptoms, contact, who to contact, or when to refer. So with the help of FAO, we're working on ascertaining the disease status of brucellosis, tuberculosis, the zoonotic diseases, which are of our interest, and we are working with, we have engaged a consultant, and FAO is working with us to ensure that we're able to ascertain the disease status, which is very important for us in the country, for planning purposes, for the government, for Ministry of Health in terms of reporting, and also for BAF to ensuring we're able to report to OIE. But apart from that, if you look at the actual processes, which are the farm practices, good agricultural practices, which you call, there is an area where production
plays a very vital role, the extension and production, where the farm hygiene, the milking shed hygiene, what are the do's and don'ts, the SOPs and so on. And I understand stakeholders are working with donor partners to improve on that. And that is an area BAF doesn't intervene, as it's a production aspect. It's not a regulatory or disease aspect. But we work with the stakeholders to ensure that they are in compliance. So holistically, we are working together to ensure that the production improves, the regulatory improves. As regulatory aspects improve or increase, the production automatically improves. So it's a win-win for both organizations as we both improve compliance. So this is the approach taken at the moment.
All right, we'll take another break. But when we come back, Riaz, I'm interested in how BAF is now partnering with animal health organizations locally in terms of improving the health of domestic animals. We'll speak about that after the break. Good evening and welcome back to the show. We are still speaking with the Executive Chair of the Biosecurity Authority of Fiji, Xavier Riaz Khan. Riaz, before we wrap up for the evening, the Biosecurity Authority has signed up with the International Atomic Energy Agency to manage fruit flies. This funding of, I think, about $2.8 million available. I didn't think fruit flies were that much of a problem.
Right. Edwin, I know fruit flies may be, which we see in our backyard gardens and so on, maybe not an issue. But if you look at, if you must have heard about Queensland fruit fly, having millions of dollars of damages up in New Zealand. And with our Fiji setting, we have seven varieties, species of fruit flies, where two are not present in Fiji, which are basically present in Rotuma. So that's why we have restrictions on movement of fruit and vegetables from Rotuma to Fiji. However, with the assistance of International Atomic Energy Agency, we're working with other partners, the Ministry of Health and other partners. We were able to secure, through a project document which we submitted for management of fruit flies. And we are in planning and execution phase where consultants have come in and basically are working with the team. That's for Rotuma, mainly for management of fruit flies. As you may be aware that there is surveillance processes and there is a high force treatment, which is high temperature forced air treatment, HTFE treatment, which is used by Nature's Way up in Nandi Airport. So that is one of the treatment measures accepted by New Zealand MPI under the bilateral quarantine agreement and also through Australia for treatment of fruit flies. Apart from International Atomic Energy Agency helping us in improving or finding measures and processes to eliminate or mitigate the fruit flies which we had on hand, however, technology advancements, biosecurity measures has all changed over time. So surveillance is very important, but if you look at the processes, it is not something which is accepted internationally. As technology has changed, as I said, thus there's new measures in place. And irradiation is one of the measures. Irradiated species introduction to control the fruit fly species is one strategy which is basically used internationally. And second is there's the use of methyl bromide and use of high temperature forced air treatment. Those are the two treatments usually used. Methyl bromide is being phased away under Montreal Protocol. So there is alter treatments which we are trying to work on with the UNEP to ensure that we're able to provide more treatment options to Fijians while they're exporting. So looking at the HTFE and the approved treatments for fruit fly mitigation and elimination, high temperature forced air is accepted by Australia and New Zealand for export of papaya, eggplant, mangoes, and breadfruit, but it's not accepted by the US market, as we're trying to export papaya and breadfruit to USA. So irradiation is what is accepted now internationally. By most or some training partners. So BAF is now working with the International Atomic Energy Agency, which we have submitted a proposal, and another €2.2 million worth project is basically worked on, and we're currently in negotiation with Ministry of Economy in terms of what sort of co-financing Fiji will do in the project. However, in March, we will have the scoping team from Vienna, and they'll be working on developing this facility. And it will be the first facility for Oceania. whilst looking at the high forced, high temperature forced treatment, it is acceptable, but we have to all understand we have to move to more towards semi-processed, and there is a way forward to eliminate the quarantine or the biosecurity hurdles which we have faced at the border. So the organization working with international partners and also the importing trading partners to ensure that we are able to improve the quarantine treatments, pre-shipments treatments, which is accepted so that our products are having a more better shelf life in New Zealand or Australian or US market. Mm-hmm. But on the same note, there's more production, more Fijians can grow, and more can be exported.
All right. We've basically come to the end of the show for this evening, but before we wrap up, Biosecurity has signed with Animals Fiji to look after the welfare of domestic animals, pets more so. Very quickly, with very limited time, how exactly are you partnering? What will you be doing?
The partnership with Animals Fiji is first, and we'll be partnering with other local partners who are basically involved in the livestock sector. However, the engagement with the Animals Fiji is mainly in regards to rabies. As you know, Fiji is a rabies-free country, and they also do testing and facilitate the export of pets. And they're also out in the field with their vets, who basically are volunteer vets and so on. And Animals Fiji is one of the organizations which you've seen has flourished over time. And with their services, we are very confident that they're more of our partners. It's more like a public-private partnership approach with Animals Fiji, where they're able to provide us information in regards to any sort of rabies or any other diseases which may be present in pets. As pet, whatever is domestically kept is also very important for us. So rabies is an area which we're working on with the Animals Fiji. But apart from that, we're also working in terms of improving the animal welfare. As that is an area which Animals Fiji has worked on a lot. And we see that Fiji doesn't have an animal welfare framework at the moment, and which we are working. However, as an organization, BEF as an organization, it cannot develop those welfare strategies locally because there's no expertise locally available.
And that's something you'll be looking for, looking to do in the future, I suppose.
Just to add on that, Edwin, the OIE had just completed a mission and legislation review, and they are coming in again for a gap mission. And that is where the donor partners will be identified to come and basically assist us in developing those strategies. However, we are aligning with our regional strategy, which is through Australia, New Zealand, and the other partners who are the WTO OIE member countries who are using. So we are seeking assistance from OIE to help us to develop that. So you may see some billboards coming up soon in our highways to ensure that we are not bumping on our cattle and our horses, as animal welfare is very important.
All right. And on that note, Riaz, I'm going to have to say thank you very much for being on the show. We're going to wrap up for this evening now. And up next is the Maise segment with Nemani Nalai Mbatiki. I'll be back again next Sunday. Until then, good night.
Good evening. I'm Nemani Nalai Mbatiki of the Fiji Sun. Welcome to Fiji's only TV editorial show. In my say this week, I will be speaking on self-reliance. Help or assistance of any kind is always appreciated, particularly in times of need. We are all grateful that government has rolled out several initiatives to help give people a leg up so that one day they can become independent and self-reliant. We should also be grateful that government did not introduce the dole system or unemployed benefit, as some developed countries like New Zealand and Australia have done. In New Zealand, for example, the dole has become the bane of that country's welfare system. It's now so entrenched in the national psyche that successive governments have faced stiff resistance as they try to scale it down and get people to work. Some families have lived on the dole for four generations. The thought of not having to go to work and still get paid every week or fortnight by the government is too tempting and a cop-out, especially for able-bodied people. Thank goodness we do not have that in Fiji. The free tuition, the free bus fare for primary, secondary school students, etc., a great incentive for our children to get educated. There is no excuse for any school-aged children to be staying at home. While education is not compulsory, there should be a way where those responsible should be held accountable. One of the tools of self-reliance is education. In this modern day and age, our children cannot afford not to be educated. New knowledge and skills empower people and open doors to opportunity. The government initiatives like the technical colleges and the small business grants help people get qualifications so that they can stand on their own 2 feet. We should not expect government to do everything for us. Since the beginning of time, man has been counseled to earn his own way, thereby becoming self-reliant. The Bible tells us that Adam, the first man, was commanded to eat from the sweat of his brow. The emphasis on self-reliance is tied closely to freedom itself. When people are self-reliant, they are free. Around the world, many programs have been set up by well-meaning individuals to help those who are in need. However, many of these programs are designed with a short-sighted objective of helping people, as opposed to helping people help themselves. Our efforts must always be directed toward making able-bodied people self-reliant. One church leader said, "We fear many parents are making gullible gulls out of their children with their permissiveness and their doling out of family resources." Parents who place their children on the dole are just as guilty as governments which place their citizens on the dole. In fact, the actions of parents in this area can be more devastating than any government program. In Fable of the Gullible Gull, the Reader's Digest in October 1950, the writer talks about these great flocks of seagulls that are starving amid a plenty. Quote, "Fishing is still good, but the gulls don't know how to fish. For generations, they have depended on the shrimp fleet to toss them scraps from the nets. Now the fleet has moved. The shrimpers had created a welfare state for the seagulls. The big birds never bothered to learn how to fish for themselves, and they never taught their children to fish. Instead, they led their little ones to the shrimp nets. Now the seagulls, the fine free birds that almost symbolize liberty itself, are starving to death because they gave in to the something for nothing lure." I will end with this quote from this church leader tonight. And he said, and I quote, "The development of our spiritual nature should concern us most. Spirituality is the highest acquisition of the soul, the divine in man, the supreme crowning gift that makes him king of all created things. It is the conscience of victory over self and of communion with the infinite. It is spirituality alone which really gives one the best in life." Close quote. I am Neman Indelemba Tiki. That was my say tonight. For more of my views, you can read the Fiji Sun.